I know our next speaker's more than ready, since he was even ready before the last speaker. We've heard quite a bit of talk about the bad custody evaluators, the people who are there to further their own agenda, to pad their own pocketbooks, or to make decisions that they think may be right, but based on wrong and faulty information and assumptions. Thank goodness there are exceptions out there who are also teaching others to do good custody evaluations, and one of those is our next speaker, Andrew Benjamin. He's both a lawyer and a family psychologist and is able to bring both dimensions into his evaluations and his ability to teach others to do competent and fair custody evaluations. Dr. Benjamin.
Thank you so much.
Well, John and David, I'm here to say that, in fact, I do believe that we have a role in working with our families that are so split. And I think we can provide really good evidence for the lawyers and the jurists involved in these cases. So let me start here. First of all, I'm a graduate out of University of Arizona, and I'm a licensed lawyer in the great state of Arizona. I'm licensed to practice clinical psychology in Washington. And John's point about the APA guidelines is accurate. They were very general. But what we did with those guidelines is we took those guidelines and actually crafted rules that psychologists, we drafted them and promulgated them through our licensing board in Washington. And those rules create standards of practice that are expected for competent custody evaluations. And I think that's really part of the answer that I hope you all take away today, is that we need to do a better job of regulating the people who not only educating, but regulating the people who are involved in the process of conducting custody evaluations. Now, you should wonder about my credibility. I would. After listening to John and David, I would think, my God, why would anybody have a role in this kind of setting? Well, I've done more than 900 of these evaluations, and I've not had an ethics complaint. Let me say that again. More than 900 evaluations, high conflict custody, family law cases, the worst of the worst cases coming out of King County in Seattle, Washington, to my program, and I've either conducted or supervised those cases and not had a complaint filed against me. I've trained now over 200 people to do these kinds of evaluations. And very few of those people have ever had an ethics complaint filed against them. Now, this is a rare phenomenon, and it suggests that the protocol that we developed out of our program might have some valid and reliable aspects to it. Because if it didn't, you can count on complaints being filed against the practitioner. And judges and lawyers, I would ask that should be one of the very first questions you find out when you think about the credibility of the psychological evidence that's being provided by some damn evaluator that's before you. Kids get hurt. If we do not rise to the standard of practices that I think need to exist throughout this country to perform competent psychological evaluations, comprehensive parenting evaluations in these cases, kids will get hurt. My clients are the kids. That's what I teach my students, and certainly what I do in my evaluations. So these are the standards for forensic evaluators, and you'll notice down here, down at the bottom, is the website link to the APA guidelines. Now, I didn't give you the Washington standards. I'm more than happy to do that. I'm also more than happy to volunteer to work with any lawyer, psychologist, or anybody else interested in creating standards within their jurisdiction, whatever state you might be from, or province for that matter. And I have worked with the BC, British Columbians, to create better standards. We maintain professional credibility and our integrity in these cases by really adopting, and this is really important, a sensitivity to our own countertransference. All of us have bias. And unless we're paying attention to how that bias might emerge within these cases, we will hurt kids. And we also have to make sure that as we go through this process, that we find ways of exacting a fair, organized approach. Now, I did qualitative research in developing the protocol that's been published by the American Psychological Association. What I'm going to talk about is how this protocol can be used to provide these trauma-informed custody case evaluations. This protocol is valid and reliable based upon, you know, thousands of hours of watching videotape of both sets of parent or mothers and fathers and children who have gone through this context. And what we did in changing the protocol is whenever we found places within these evaluations where people felt surprised, where people felt betrayed, where people felt abandoned or misunderstood, we would rethink that aspect of the protocol. Bottom line, unless people feel like they've been fairly treated, they're not going to change their behavior. They're not going to change their behavior. And these evaluations are a form of therapeutic jurisprudence, in my view. And we want to use the findings that emerge from these evaluations to help parents become better at parenting, certainly better at communicating with each other, if they can, if we even can get them to that point. In many instances, we can't. Many instances, we have domestic violence in the case. And as that emerges, the data emerge to corroborate that domestic violence has occurred, we can set up very straightforward recommendations that can help inform the lawyers how to get settlement out of that case, how to move that person into treatment and make sure that the kids and the mother usually gets protected. So we avoid the appearance of bias in large part by being the kind of exacting the persona of being a very caring, fair person, open to all the possibilities as the evaluation process unfolds. And we make sure that we seek information differentially across many different types of measures to test hypotheses. We don't rush to a judgment on any particular finding. So all of our evaluations are court-ordered. We want the court involved in the process from the beginning. We want the court, in fact, to send questions that the court would like us to address. We'd like the lawyers involved in those court-ordered evaluations to send questions that they want addressed. And then we get an elaborate questionnaire filled out by both of the parties. It's not a grammar test, including a 28 domestic violence screening instrument, where David talked about the various factors that are covered across all those measures. Well, we want to find out if any of those behaviors have occurred. Because these evaluations, in my view, need to be driven by behavior. The best predictor of future behavior is past behavior. So we're checking about all aspects of potential control and domination that might have occurred within this relationship. We also make sure that we're going to operationalize the parenting behaviors that need to change with very good concrete examples within the report, in a rich narrative report, so that the lawyers and judges can work out through counseling at law how to affect the party that they're representing or the party they're ruling for. So they come in looking like this, right? You know, and this is the problem. This is really the problem. They're very interpersonally sensitive. These people that the judges order into evaluation literally are the most interpersonally sensitive among all of us in this culture. And in fact, they might even look like this. And sometimes they're really like that. Sometimes. So we want to, because judges get to this place where they've got multiple allegations raised by both parties, want to get to this place where we can provide good psychological evidence that the judges can rely upon about domestic violence, mental illness, substance abuse, economic strain, other kinds of issues, educational deficits, whatever. We're open to all questions that the jurists and lawyers might have. So this is the overview of our process. I'm going to go through the process. In particular, the most important aspect of our process. It's really important that throughout the process, no matter whether you're working with the batterer or the person who has been battered, seems fair. If you're going to use cognitive dissonance to get people to change, they need to have compelling data that emerge from this process. They need to feel like they've been heard. And so we avoid the surprises, and we make sure that we're videotaping these evaluations, and under no circumstances are we letting our data enter the report unless it's been corroborated by multiple measures. We limit ex parte contact with the lawyers and judges involved in this contact in this business just to writing. We're happy to get written questions. We want everybody papered up. We want to make sure, again, that the parties feel like they've been fairly treated. And by the time they get to us, more often than not, they haven't felt treated well. They have felt that their lawyer often has failed them. They have felt that other professionals within the system have failed them. They're pretty angry and pretty distressful. We screen out the inappropriate cases. If there's a criminal charge against any person within that's been ordered into our process, we send a note back to the court and we ask the court to suspend the order until the criminal case has been prosecuted. Surprisingly, we still get cases where there's been a criminal charge, but nevertheless, we wait until that evidence is in. We obtain the concrete referral questions that I talked about. We make sure that we send out a lengthy disclosure statement laying out all the steps of our process. It's a 5-page set of steps. We want people to know what we're going to be asking, how we're going to be asking, and when we're going to be asking them. We don't want to surprise them, right? We collect our fees up front to avoid the multiple relationship problem that John was talking about. And we have a sliding fee scale. And we'll slide down to as low as $100 per party. And we make sure that we distribute the initial testing and consider those results to inform our structured interview. All right, so these are the kinds of questions that we will get besides our standard DV questions. We'll get this back from both of the parties before we move into interviews. When we get to the interview, we make sure that we're finishing the disclosure process that occurs up front. We do administer psychological testing. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. That the evaluation is allegation-driven. Any concern that a party has raised, we'll investigate. We'll evaluate. We'll make sure that concern is noted up. We integrate the data immediately. For every hour we spent with a party, we spend an hour report writing. And we make sure that we send out that report, the beginnings of that report to the party that we've interviewed, so that the facts can be checked. And if the facts come back and they're not right, what does that raise? It raises the hypothesis that bias has occurred, that our countertransference has affected our clinical judgment. And that, of course, leads to consultation, and maybe even withdrawing from the evaluation. In some instances, we've had to do that. We make sure that we're paying attention to what we know from the clinical research about judgment, Psychologists are very prone to clinical judgment errors. You can see down here a whole list: over-reliance on memory, confirmatory and hindsight bias, and over-reliance on unique data are the risk primarily that psychologists suffer from. That's one of the reasons why we always are writing contemporaneously with our interviews. We're making sure that we integrate those data immediately. Our evaluations are broad-based and multi-measured. And this really borrows from the law, because we know that the law really is an adversarial process. And when we have two parties that are able to share their concerns in a safe place, away from the threat of cross-examination, and they're fully heard and fully understood around those concerns, we're going to get the best evidence. It's going to emerge. And we're going to use those multiple measures so that as that evidence emerges, we don't rush to judgment based upon just one data point. We're looking for multiple measure corroboration. If we don't get multiple measure corroboration, we're not arriving at any kind of finding about any evidence. We can honestly report back to the judge, we don't know. This allegation was raised, but we don't know. There wasn't enough evidence that emerged during the process to make a finding. So this cartoon says, I put them up after the divorce so he knows his father is still part of his life. We get that kind of parent. And it also has something to do with psychological testing because, you know, David's absolutely right. Our psychological testing at this point isn't very refined. Doesn't really work for this population. What it can help with, though, is to generate hypotheses. And that's why we continue to do psychological testing. We use standardized questions. This is something recommended by one of the very best papers in our field, written by Emory and Company. We're using those standardized questions to really draw out from the parties their concerns. And we're making sure, John, that there's no multiple relationships because we got the money up front. And we know that the lawyers will continue to come back to us if they feel their parties have been fairly treated. They do. We don't have lawyers that are filing ethics complaints against us. And they would. And they do. Against our other colleagues, John. Can you turn that up?
I was bruised and battered, I couldn't tell what I felt. I was unrecognizable to myself.
You know, I gotta say that parties going through this process are probably more crazy than any other place except for Saturday night ER rooms in major metropolitan cities. If the judges are ordering them into evaluation, the judges are completely baffled. They don't send people to us lightly. And I really want to make sure that we address those parties' concerns because they're real. They may be very interpersonally sensitive, that is true, but those concerns are real and they need to be addressed. So we get releases of information up front, and we make sure that anybody that has firsthand information about any of the allegations that the parties are concerned about will provide us a declaration, particularly non-professionals. We get declarations or affidavits because under the laws of the particular jurisdiction, they swear they're not committing perjury. This is important. It's one of the ways of protecting the fairness of the process. So if somebody's willing to write an affidavit or declaration, we are willing to interview that person as an important collateral, particularly if they got firsthand information. This cartoon says, thank you, Adrian. Parenting is a learning process and your criticisms help. Now, one of the very best aspects of our evaluation process is observations with the parent and the child or children. They provide very rich data. And Dr. Walker is absolutely right. You know, kids will concentrate on the loving parts of their parents. And even though that's very, very true, their baseline behaviors parenting behaviors that often don't emerge in these observations. And when they don't emerge, it helps inform our process. We also have, despite those children focusing on the loving parts of their parents, parents engaging in behavior, very lamentable behavior that smacks of emotional abuse. Incredible, but it happens. And on occasion, we'll have flat-out startle responses going on as a parent reaches across a child for a toy and the kid startles as if about ready to be beaten. You know, so that's the kind of data that'll emerge in these observations. With teenagers, of course, we're getting rich information about discipline, about chores, about the values of those parents and how those values are meted out within the home context. Very important information to incorporate as part of the multiple measure cooperation. We always use the legal factors to organize the psychological evidence. You know, our judge Fields was right on target with this. You know, I'm kind of misquoting a little bit, bear with me, I really feel as if the psychological evaluations have to be informed by the legal factors that the lawyers and judges are working with. If you organize the psychological evidence under those legal factors, those lawyers are much more able to reach settlement. Used to be that about 60% of our cases got settled. Towards the end of the program, five, 6 years of the program, almost 99% of our cases settle. The lawyers can use the data if it's structured well. And we incorporate a discussion about how the data really corroborate the limiting factors that have to occur. So if there's a finding about domestic violence, we're showing those data very clearly with actual examples of what has happened in those DV cases so that the judges can, or the lawyers can usually reach settlement around how that parent will have no contact and access with the kid until specific treatment occurs and specific protections are set in place and followed by the offending parent.
Been dazed and confused for so long, it's not true.
So it's often you get so many data in this context that it could be confusing. It can lead to confusion. But, you know, if evaluators keep their eye on the ball, the data actually do begin to show the patterns that can lead to good findings. It's what Dr. Walker suggested in the beginning. Domestic violence isn't a one-time incident. Mental health issues aren't a one-time incident. Substance abuse is a one-time incident. You're going to have patterns that'll cut across all areas of the life you're trying to understand, and those facts will emerge from the various measures. So, when we move out of the observation process, this is the time where we write up our evaluation report, a rough draft of our entire evaluation report. We do this before we even interview any of the collaterals or look at any of the collateral documentation. Now, this is an aspect of our protocol that is controversial to many of my colleagues in psychology. I have to say that we do this because it's a matter of fairness. When we looked at the material beforehand, we were often accused of being prejudiced by the folks that became before us. And we didn't want to be accused of being biased by other professionals that have been involved in this case. So we just avoided that altogether, and frankly, it leads to, I think, a much more valid evaluation report, because the findings that emerged have been written up as a rough draft. Where there is multiple measure corroboration, we've already identified that corroboration. Where there are rival hypotheses, we're beginning to see those emerge. And in many instances, some of our initial hypotheses have to be rejected because there hasn't been sufficient evidence that has emerged at that point. Nevertheless, we'll test whether, because of the collaterals that were given, whether there was any firsthand information about some of those allegations that weren't tested, which weren't emerging with multiple measure corroboration. And so that's a check on our evaluation process. Some of the best evidence is coming from firsthand observations, and frankly, the very best evidence is an actual omission from the person involved in the behavior. So we send a written summary whenever we conduct a collateral interview to the collateral. The day we do the collateral interview, we make sure that there's a meeting of the minds around what we heard from the set of questions we've asked. And we interview particular people much later in the process, really at the very end, right before we interviewed the party in the closing interview. For instance, a paramour, we would never, ever interview until right before we're giving the feedback to the party in our closing interview, because that paramour is likely to change her story. And if that paramour is a potential DV victim, we want to give her sufficient information right before we interview the person involved in domestic violence, because in most instances, we're now getting admissions from the batterer about his battering. It's a way of protecting his second paramour. We reject material that doesn't bear directly on the allegations. Collaterals, professionals in particular, are very chatty and love to raise information that just isn't relevant in light of the concerns raised by the parties and the questions raised by the lawyers and the judge in the case. And we do make sure, again, that we're paying particular attention to those issues that will lead us to be able to protect the children. So this is the very toughest part of the process for most psychologists. And most of my colleagues wimp out. They're not meeting with the people they're evaluating. Now, you heard Dr. Walker say that she does, bless her heart, that she's a rarity. And I think it's so critically important that you lawyers and you judges make sure that this occurs when you're asking about an expert's methodology. Make sure that this is part of the process, in large part because, you know, by the time we get to the closing meeting, we have more than enough evidence at that point to go through with the party, and we should. We want to do that. We want to be fair and respectful with this party. And again, we want to close a door on later complaint about that party being unfairly treated. And so we give that party, if they disagree with a particular finding, some additional time to submit other evidence that we may have missed. So we'll get parties exasperated at us and dissatisfied with this. But what happens is we lay out each damning fact that has led to a particular finding, one fact after the other. That cracks denial. That cracks the minimization that goes on in many of these cases. And parties come away, again, feeling respected and fairly treated. They may not like what has been found by them about them, but when they admit to an aspect of the facts that have led to a finding, for instance, about domestic violence, we'll ask for other information about the time that they thought was the worst domestic violence they perpetrated. And when we get those disclosures, that's cognitive dissonance. That person is going to be much more likely to change in batterer's treatment. We meet with the lawyers and with the GAL as a group, and we issue the final report at that point. And it's important that they are permitted a follow-up conference if they want, because they haven't, we don't give them any chance to read the report at that meeting. We want those lawyers to really test our credibility by raising the concerns that they have in vivo without being really elaborately prepared. Works a little bit better. Lawyers spend less money, less of their clients' money that way, too.
She say, don't give a say your soul away, cause all that you have is your soul.
That's how we don't give our soul away, John. We don't. I just want to say that for any psychologist out there, if you're willing to conduct pro bono cases, we need you. The judges need you. And I'm happy to serve as a free consultant, no matter what your jurisdiction is, and I'll share all of my materials with you for free if you'll do pro bono cases. And I'll make sure that you will learn about the standards of practice that can result in fair evaluations being conducted on people who desperately need these kinds of evaluations. Thank you very much for listening to me.